Welcome to Oregon Voters Digest, the program that brings forward the social and political issues that are important to people living here in the Pacific Northwest. And now, your host, Bruce Broussard.
Welcome, folks, to the Oregon Voters Digest. I'm Bruce Broussard, your host. By George, we're going to have quite a show today. And right before the show, we're going to start doing a little beginning now. I think I need to talk a little bit about history. We're going to do a little historical kind of a deal, kind of set the format, if you will, and educate you across the board. And naturally, as you can see, I've donned my Marine Corps uniform on. I got my cover on. I got a Navy dude sitting over here on my far right. His name is Joe Walsh. And boy, I tell you, it's just exciting. And then this other person, we'll talk about her in a minute. But the bottom line is that we're talking about vets right now, okay? And we want to impress upon the voting public who's basically making sure that vets are being taken care of. And in all due respect, that's what this person kind of, she's there as a layperson. But the fact of the matter is we got Joe here. And I just want to remind those vets that are out there, hey, look here. As you can see, Joe's, he's had his issues and whatever. But the fact of the matter is he's being able to take advantage of some of the services that are involved, that's there for vets. If it's for a service is concerned, right? Because I've done the same thing. But one of the things I want to impress upon you is that for those of you who are family members or this, that, and the other, wives or cousins or whatever, and you have a vet that has not actually been taking advantage of those services with the VA, you need to know how to go about doing that. And here's the deal. Here it is right here. There it is. Federal benefits for veterans, department, and survivors. This is it. This is the Bible. They print this publication every year, once a year, aspect of it. And all you have to do is just call up the VA benefits. You can Google it or whatever. It's a 1-800 number, 1-800-827-1000. 1-800-827-1000. And right up front, where the first thing they're going to do is they're going to send you down there to get a card like this. And what this is, it just basically tells you you're a vet. If you're Army, they'll put a logo there that says Army. I'm in the Marine Corps. There it is right there. Right there. Once you get that, then you go and visit the provider. It's perfect. So please, burial, the whole nine yard, one stop. Things are really going great. In fact, in the city of Portland, they've got new homes now for homeless. They got homes over there now. They're building new structures around and whatever. So again, if you've got a cousin or whatever that's a homeless vet, please take advantage of this situation. And by the way, when you see a person with a sign sitting on a corner saying, I'm a vet, give them with their hats out saying, I need a dollar or two and whatever, ask them to see a card. If they don't have no card, you don't give them no money. If you want to, you can put them in the car and take them down to the VA and just have them go through the process right up front. If they're mentally ill, they'll take care of that too. If you got a problem, if you figure that they are mental or whatever, no, I hate to put it that way, but call the cops, and then you tell the cops to take them on down to the VA and they'll take care of their problems or whatever. But I want you to know, make sure they've got this card. There it is right there. There's the card right there. Okay, fine. That's that part. Now, the other thing we're going to do, and I'm going to be brief real quick, we're going to do a little sort of little history aspect of it. And what I mean by history on one of the subject matters we're going to be talking about here today. This is a continuation on our show last week. I had these two people right here, and it's Mimi. Mimi and Joe did an excellent job last week, and I was so glad to be a part and parcel of this particular process. And one of those subject matter was the whole issue of Black Americans, of Portland, Black issues revolving around issues here in Portland as far as Black folks, Black residents. And you know, we still have that reputation that we're the whitest city in the country, for that matter. And we want to improve that piece right up front with it. So the bottom line, we've got publications that are out here within our community, within the Portland community, that in all due respect, the expectation from the white community is that they want to get their news from it. I'll be right up front with you. We've got the Scanner newspaper. We've got the Scanner newspaper. And we got the Portland Observer newspaper. And then next, we've got an Asian newspaper, because these are all kind of like identified as minorities. And I'll just be right up front with you. I wanted to kind of get some stuff into the Asian newspaper, but they're not into politics. They say they don't get involved in politics. But the two other newspapers, and the oldest Black newspaper in the state of Oregon, is the Portland Observer. And but you've got another one, a gentleman by the name of Bernie Foster, does this, the Scanner newspaper. That's it right there. And so I guess the point I'm making here is that when we had this whole issue about this shooting of this teenager here by Portland Police Department, it's an issue right now. Everybody's having discussions and whatever. And so the name of the game is this: we got to resolve that problem. It's like successful, to be successful. You know, to be successful, it's like the issues, whatever, okay? Let's take care of the business. So I would hope that the scanner and the observer and possibly the Asian reporter will do something similar like that of the Oregonian. The Oregonian had this issue on the front page, of the newspaper. It's a state newspaper, so it must be an issue because it qualified itself. But the idea is that, in all due respect, to translate that and get the views from the black community and from another major minority newspaper, the Asian Reporter, they should have something in there in those respective publications. I think that's very, very important if, in fact, we're going to get this behind us. Mm-hmm. We're all suffering. We all want to know what's going on. And quit pointing fingers and demanding this, that, the other. The bottom line is that only certain people will just get out and start talking about these issues. And I just happen to have them with me today. And I want to thank you guys for being here. You did an excellent job last week.
Thank you. I really
appreciate that very much. And hopefully the viewing audience will share the shows that we've done now. It is on YouTube. These shows repeat itself. You'll be seeing the lineup or whatever. So we're just going to jump right up in here, and I'm just going to quit talking. But the bottom line is that they're going to give us an overview of kind of like where we were last week and where we are today, this subject and other subjects that we talked about, and we just want to get just throw it out the way. And we're going to go start off with you, Mimi. Okay with you?
Yeah, sure.
Okay.
So,
well, identify yourself first from the standpoint of who you are and why you're here. Okay.
Thank you. I have been an activist for a long time, for decades, and here I'm not affiliated with a group. I support quite a few groups, and mostly do action around whatever is needed, whether it's people are freezing to death on the streets, we try to get there with blankets before they freeze to death. I look at it as doing the work that the city isn't doing. So instead of having people who are marginalized and the most vulnerable in our city failing to the point of death through the system, we try to pay attention and say, this needs help, this needs to be seen, and first things first, on the ground level, take care of that, and then take it to city council.
How long have you been doing this? How long have you been doing this about?
Well, activism for probably 35 years.
35 years?
Yeah.
Wow. Mm-hmm. You got background.
Yeah.
All in Portland?
No, East Coast.
East Coast?
Yeah,
okay.
I've been out here since 95.
Since 95. Mm-hmm. So you've been very active along those.
Yeah.
Okay, good. That's good.
Mm-hmm.
Joe, why don't you throw it up, and then we'll start getting into discussion. How about you, Joe? I know you're military, right? Military and Navy, right?
I spent 9 years in the Navy.
9 years in the Navy.
62 to 71,
okay.
Most of the Vietnam War. And then in 69, I wrote a letter to the Chief of Naval Operations opposing the war. And from there, I was honorably discharged.
Mm-hmm.
But I lost all my security clearances, and they were really unhappy because I was a career petty officer.
Right, okay.
And they didn't know what to do with that. Normally, the people that file paperwork would be people that had 1 or 2 years in. Somebody that had almost 10 years in, and so I was kind of unusual, so they were really angry with me.
Mm-hmm.
My last ship, the XO, said, if anybody who doesn't want to be on my ship, raise his hand. So I raised my hand, and then I want to be on your ship. So that started my activism,
okay.
And I've been
okay.
doing it ever since, 1969.
Really? Wow.
All the way to 70. I got out of the Navy 70 and spent 3 years in a peace movement in San Diego.
Mm-hmm. How
we did a lot of actions
okay.
in LA and also in San Diego.
Okay.
And we worked with Jane Fonda when she came to town. And Donald Sutherland and Peter Boyle and those people that put shows on. We did a lot of protests against the war. Individuals for Justice started in front of Blumenauer's office.
How long was that ago about?
That was 2008.
2008.
We started because we petitioned Blumenauer to call for the impeachment of Bush for the invasion.
Our present congressperson, right?
Yes.
Earl Blumenauer?
Yeah, he's still here.
District, right?
He's still here with his bicycle and his bow tie.
Yeah.
We asked him to call for the impeachment of Bush.
Mm-hmm.
The impeachment is just in the House. It's not in the Senate. The original impeachment is in the House.
Okay.
They come up with charges, and then it goes to the Senate for trial.
Okay.
We just wanted him to call for the investigation part of it.
Did he get involved?
No. He refused to do it. We spent 2 years outside his office. 2 years. Wouldn't do it. DeFazio did it. We didn't even ask DeFazio to do it, but he did it anyway.
Wow.
I was on a radio show, that liberal show that used to be on KPOJ, I think it was.
Okay.
Air America?
Air America. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, those guys. We got a message in the middle of the show that Congressman DeFazio had come out and said he wants to see the impeachment of Bush. And we didn't even ask him.
Hmm.
And Blumenauer would never do it. That's how Individual for Justice started. We have no rules. We have no meetings. We have no dues. We just show up. So somebody will put something on Facebook. For instance, Condoleezza Rice was coming to Portland about 2 years ago.
Okay.
And we said we were going to do a protest outside of the Hilton.
Okay.
And she canceled.
Huh.
She canceled.
Really? Really?
And we asked the guys, why did she cancel? We had Hilton. And they said, she didn't want to deal with the protest.
Wow.
So when people say, do protests work? Yes, they do.
Mm-hmm.
All the time? No. But what else is there?
But it's still for the good of the people, right?
That's right. If you feel strongly about something, then you should go to your politician and say, I want you to do this.
Mm-hmm.
And if they say no, then you ought to put pressure on them.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Like, especially if we're talking about life and death.
Yeah.
And that's what we're talking about here last week and this week.
Mm-hmm.
We had a child that was killed on his knees with 3 bullets. Who did that? Our police department. That's stunning. I've been arrested a lot. Never been convicted, but arrested a lot. When they put the handcuffs on you and you go on your knees, that's submission.
Mm-hmm.
You're not fighting them anymore.
Mm-hmm.
You're on your knees and you're giving up. If they tell you to get on your knees before the handcuffs, your hands go up.
Mm-hmm.
So you're out of balance. So it's really tricky. If you go down on your knees with your hands up, it's really tricky not to put your hands down on the ground.
Mm-hmm.
We think that's what happened.
Mm-hmm. I might add on that little piece, just real quick, like an Oregonian, his mother was featured on the Oregon with a photo, and she says, they made a statement, Venus Hayes, whose son, Quincy Hayes, 17,
Quanis.
Was, right?
Quanis Hayes.
Quanis.
Mm-hmm.
Hayes, 17, was fatally shot by Portland police. Says she doesn't think the full truth about his shooting has been released.
She wants to federal investigation.
There's an interesting issue that's on this piece, okay?
Mm-hmm.
All right, good. All right, go on.
I mean, if you take the words of the police department out of that scenario, you would be outraged. Say, who shoots a 17-year-old kid on his knees?
Mm-hmm.
What is that about?
Mm-hmm.
You know, what, did they catch those criminals who did that?
Mm-hmm.
No. We have never, ever indicted a police officer for shooting an African-American person in Portland. Never.
Mm.
And it's also extended, I think, to the minority community as a whole. We have never. So when the mayor says, well, you know, it's, the county is holding this grand jury and, you know, we're going to present the evidence and stuff.
Right.
We've never indicted anybody. So what is that? There's something wrong with that. If this child was on its knees and someone blew him away and we can't charge them with at least manslaughter, what is the matter with us? What's wrong with Portland?
But that's the process we have in place right now.
Yes.
What can we throw on the table for a solution on this piece?
Well, I don't think you can throw a solution until you have a greater understanding of what's going on.
Right.
And I think that I know for sure, hearing people's comments about what happened and what's been happening with why people are outraged in city council is completely either misunderstood by so many. I'm talking, you know, hundreds of thousands of people don't understand what's going on.
Mm-hmm.
And the other is that they don't care. Because they're white, and this happened to a black family, yet another black family.
Mm-hmm.
And we talked last week about reframing, and my thoughts about how the city and the media reframe these situations so that we don't understand what is going on.
Mm-hmm.
It's specific, it has a purpose, reframing. And the purpose works for the politicians, and it works for the cops, but it never works, and it can't ever work for the people who are affected and afflicted by police violence and police murders. Mm-hmm. And the reframing looks like, I wrote this out because it's interesting to see it. I've heard people, many, well, he was guilty. So, you know, what are you all supporting or fighting for something to be done over the death of this punk, you know? That's one thing. He was a robber. He was a thief. He had a gun. He was black. Mm-hmm. That's the one that they don't say. Mm-hmm. I mean, they do say it, but that's the one that people who talk about don't say, you know? And then when the outburst and the pain and the absolute terror and sadness and desperation is visual, let's say in city council or in protests or in marches, these same people who listen to or say, well, he was guilty, what's the big deal, they say, what are you all screaming about? And they repeat this reframing. He was a robber. And the only people who say he was a robber are these people, because not even the media says that. The media will say the cops were looking for a robber, somebody who held a guy in his car, you know, as whatever, and all of these things. These things were not proven. We have a judicial system that is supposed to work for people like Qantas, who is convicted already because a cop said it looks like the description that we got, which was a black man. And then they had days, they had weeks, the cops, to put their story together. They had weeks to reframe what happened. Back to reframing. I mean, this thing, is, it has to be understood that before our white community starts saying the most heinous and racist things about what happened. I mean, I'm so embarrassed so many times, especially in the city, to be white because of what is said by the white community, that they believe the police, who don't even know what they're doing. They're just like, well, it looks like him. And then reframe it. Most likely, plant things on him. They do this all the time. These things have been proven over the years, but much after the fact, after a cop murders somebody. You know, they find out 10 years later, oh, hey, that happened. But it's too late because the judicial system wasn't given a chance and the cops became the executioners.
But what about the process that was done? They had a grand jury. He went before the grand jury.
That was after the fact. First, he gets murdered because he's black.
Right, okay.
Yeah.
But then, but now we got the grand jury. And they've come out, i.e., from the standpoint of what was it? What's the term that they use? The reference that they would not charge the policeman who
he's
did
not
the
indicted.
Shooting. He's not indicted.
Right,
aspect
he gets
of
to
it.
Walk.
And
mm-hmm.
then the mayor announced that part.
Right.
The
well,
criminal indictment.
Right. Right.
Yeah.
But what if, in all due respect, the mayor is the? I want to ask. Get some response from this. But what if the mayor, who is supposed to be the commander in chief, right? He's the mayor of the city of Portland, so he's the commander-in-chief. What if the mayor had come out and looked at, he's got a staff, the whole nine yards, and looked at this whole incident, right? He got access to police department, he got access to everybody. And then after he got through putting that piece together, he would come out with his opinion, and then maybe announce the fact, well, look, it's going to go to this grand jury, but my opinion now is whether it was not right. The guy did this and this, or didn't do, you know, one way or the other.
Right.
You think if the mayor had come out with an opinion representing the people, right? First,
that, and then with the, then it's they, not it's not an opinion that we needed from him. What we needed from him is for the mayor to say, okay, we are going to make this transparent.
Right.
We are going to have the DA open everything, and this is going to happen.
Right,
it's not just me, the mayor, saying this.
Okay.
This is it's going to be open. And then the DA has to do his part and allow this
to... And keep the grand jury too, right? You keep that, you still keep that in place?
Because what happens is... So the mayor should have made a definitive statement saying, I want this to occur.
He had access to it.
And he didn't say that. What he said was, it was very passive. It was, we're going to try to create a transparent process. And
by releasing
still,
the papers
right,
later on.
Down and that still hasn't happened.
Yeah, right.
So
right.
Either the mayor lied about that, mm-hmm. or just was saying something to appease Venus Hayes, Qantas's mother, and mm-hmm. his family mm-hmm. by saying that. Because mm-hmm. when he said that, we had just... there was a recess at City Council because there was such an uproar mm-hmm. over...
That was this past Wednesday, right?
No. When he spoke to the family, it was a few councils ago.
Really?
Yeah, and it was in the hallway, and there's a picture of this all the time that the press uses. Yeah.
Okay.
But none of that's happened. Hmm. So now Hearst, and I just read this, and I don't know if it's factual, because I just saw it this morning, that Officer Hearst is the cop who killed Qantas Hayes.
Okay.
And he's the one who gets to walk. He killed a mentally ill person, I think, 3 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
And where these dots connect is, what I read this morning was, he is also very close friends with the DA.
Mm.
Now, that's what I don't know. I just read that this morning, mm-hmm. so I don't know, but interesting. And not surprising. But here's the other piece of that.
Well, that was a white guy that he shot.
It doesn't matter. He's mentally ill,
okay.
which is what the history of... Okay. This is why the DOJ came in the first place.
Okay.
Not necessarily from him. It
okay.
went back before that. But okay. our cops kill mentally ill people
okay.
and black people. So
okay.
the DOJ came in. But what was... released yesterday was this police training log is at the center of the chief's investigation.
Hmm.
And where this comes into Andrew Hearst, who's the guy who killed Qantas Hayes, is this. There was a recent training for command staff about the use of what's called employee information system. It's a computer-based system intended to identify at-risk employees, i.e. cops,
mm-hmm.
okay, who have a high number of complaints or a pattern of excessive use of force.
Hmm.
That's Andrew Hearst. There are many, but that's Andrew Hearst. What happened was, what ended up happening was Marshman didn't go to that.
That's the chief of police.
Yeah, he didn't go. He got signed in, but he wasn't there. And this whole employee information system was something that the DOJ had demanded happen so that our police force could start to identify at-risk cops so that our black community and our mentally ill community, i.e. houseless community as well, partially, would not be killed. And you know what happened? Not only didn't Marshman follow through on this, but the police lied. The police department. We have been previously informed by PPB that some
PPB, what is that, Pete? From the police?
Yeah, the Bureau. That some type of systematic review for EIS, which is the employee information system,
mm-hmm.
that these flags would occur, though we see no evidence of it. And yet the cops told the people who are from, you know, the in line from the DOJ, watching this.
Federal, right?
They lied.
Yeah.
Our cops lied. And people, and this goes back to
so
the white
So how do we
thing.
Trust them?
Right, and this goes back to the white community, who is so, like, incredibly racist here. I find that what I've seen is it's in
the liberal community. An article like that we're talking about now, about this shooting in the Oregonian, if you read the comments,
mm-hmm.
right, they're
yeah,
awful.
They're
absolutely awful.
They're so awful.
So you say to yourself, we're supposed to be a progressive city.
Right.
People are supposed to question. People
yep.
are supposed to understand how things work and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And you read these racist, outrageous,
mm-hmm.
racist statements by the readers of the Oregonian, the only big newspaper that we have.
Yeah.
We have the small one,
right.
but this is our major newspaper,
mm-hmm.
and you read them, there's 184 really lousy, stinking statements by people that don't know what they're talking about,
mm-hmm.
don't know anything about what happened.
Except
they just say, well, he was a teenager and he had a gun. And who told you that? The cops.
Right.
The cops
that's
lie
right.
all the time.
Exactly. And
they are the only organization that is trained to lie.
Mm-hmm.
Because in interrogations, they're allowed to lie to get the criminals to confess. Supreme Court gave them that power. So they're trained how to lie.
Mm-hmm.
And they lie all the time.
Mm-hmm. And in this article, they say, according to their report, they found no evidence that the system administrators had examined, as required, the criteria for flags to be sent to police supervisors on officers of concern. Mm. So Marshman, now I don't know if this is why he was, you know.
Chief, right?
Yeah, I don't know if this is why he, you know, I don't know what he's done. Mm-hmm. But this is very telling. And
it's fraud.
These lies kill people.
When you have somebody sign you in on an official police record, that's fraud. That's a felony. Mm-hmm. So will he be charged with that? I think so, but he should be.
Again, the chain of command and the process. The mayor is kind of like the lead person, chief of police, the commander in chief, if you will, right? Mm-hmm. You got me? So the orders are really, in most cases, are being taken by he's the immediate supervisor of everybody below.
Except he can't control what happens in the DA's office. It's really different.
Now that's the county. That's Multnomah County.
I don't know. I don't know the whole thing. But
yeah, DA's office is county.
That's the county.
The DA, behind closed doors with the grand jury.
Oh yeah.
This has also been proven throughout city after city, mm-hmm. that they ask leading questions of the jurors. So. I can't give an example, but basically saying, well, can you help me out with like a leading question?
A leading question would be, well, Bruce, if somebody threatened you,
oh yeah, right,
would you react?
Yes, I have.
Of course,
yes,
you would react.
Yes, right.
Okay, if somebody threatened your life, would you react strongly?
Mm-hmm.
If somebody threatened your family, would you react?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
If somebody came at you with a gun, mm-hmm. how would you react,
mm-hmm.
if you had a gun and you were a police officer?
Mm-hmm.
And then they
put... That sets the stage.
Then they add Hearst.
You notice I didn't say anything about a 17-year-old child.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I didn't say anything about that.
Yeah.
I just said somebody coming at you.
Mm-hmm.
And now you're a white person,
mm-hmm.
that has an ingrained fear,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
of black males.
Yeah.
That's been studied everywhere.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Boom. Mm-hmm. You're on a jury. You say, mm-hmm. hey, okay, the cop had a shoot. He had a shoot.
Which is exactly why they load up white people. And it's exactly why often, well, here, maybe not often, but I've heard, grand jury jurists, I guess, mm-hmm. they're called, afterwards saying, oh, I didn't know that. I didn't know the truth.
What about the makeup of the grand jury? Does it look like a diversity kind of a situation? Or?
I can't answer that.
It'll look like Portland.
Don't you
because
think
you have
help?
A very small section of Portland that is African American.
Yeah.
I think you only have about 30,000,
mm-hmm.
out of 600,000.
Mm-hmm.
So if you do a proportional setting on a grand jury, you may be lucky if you have one African American on, mm-hmm. that grand jury.
Right.
And in the grand jury, the prosecution presents the case.
Mm-hmm.
And if the prosecution, mm-hmm. is friendly with the police, mm-hmm. they do not present the same type of case that they would present against me.
Right. Exactly.
They're not enthusiastic.
Mm.
They go through the motions, and that's why we can't get the indictments. What we really need is an organization that's totally independent,
mm-hmm.
okay,
and can come down with indictments,
well, who appoints,
subpoenas.
Who appoints the?
Let me tell you what Venus Hayes wants, because this
you're called. You're called to the grand jury. You're called to the jury pool, and you could end up on the federal grand jury or the county grand jury,
mm-hmm.
And that's a decision that's made by the DA or the federal prosecutors.
Mm-hmm. Okay, okay.
That they can throw you off at any time.
And one little quick note, you made mention about the fact that the number of blacks that are here in the city of Portland, but the definition of a black falls under one roof as a minority.
Mm-hmm.
Why couldn't they have gotten a minority, at least one position? Because you got Asians, you got blacks, you got the Hispanics, etc. One person to just play musical chairs with that situation and let at least have some representation as far as those minority groups. Fair?
See, you want to do something. That's the problem. We do not have people in office right now that want to do something. They want to talk about it,
mm-hmm.
and I have a new term for it. It's called sugar words.
Sugar words?
Sugar words.
Sugar words.
Mm-hmm.
When they,
mm-hmm.
speak and they use these sugar words, mm-hmm. like, We want equality. We want diversity. We want all these things. Mm-hmm. Sugar, if you put it in hot water, dissipates. You can't see it anymore. Mm. You know, and that's what it's like. Mm. The next day, their words are gone. Wow. There's no action.
Wow.
And that's what we need. You want to do something. Mimi wants to do something. I want to do something. Does Ted Wheeler want to do something? The jury's out on that one.
I got you. Tell you what. Looks like we're going to take a short break. We'll be right back. We'll start with you.
Okay.
Is that fair?
Uh-huh.
Take a short break. We'll be right back.
You are watching Oregon Voters Digest. This program can be seen again on these channels on these dates and times. Tell a friend.
Folks, Oregon Voters Digest. I'm Bruce Broussard, your host, and again, we've been talking about. We're basically doing a kind of a recap of last week's show, and we're just kind of bringing it up to date. And I've got the same two people that were here last week, and Mimi, and Joe. Outstanding, great. Well, tell me this. You know, we start this whole thing out from the standpoint that you guys weren't given enough time before City Hall, and that 3 minutes for some strange it didn't work. But now, is it working now a bit better? Better than 3 minutes?
This is much better than
much
3 minutes.
Much better?
Unfortunately, it's not
would,
for the,
it
you
It would
know,
have been
the,
great if the mayor showed up.
Yeah, yeah.
We could have him right there.
Yeah, yeah.
And we could talk to him.
Yeah, yeah.
And we would be dignified.
Yeah.
And we wouldn't yell at him.
Yeah.
Because we would have the time to explore alternatives. Ted has made us the enemy.
Mm.
And we are not the enemy. The enemy is the lack of transparency at city council meetings. You have to remember
the enemy is lack of action.
The lack of action, the lack of transparency, the lack of action, the lack of accountability, the lack of them
racism.
Responding to us, racism inside the council, right?
Mm-hmm.
And them saying to us, we are the enemy.
Mm-hmm.
You have to remember the shooting of Mr. Hayes took place in the middle of us screaming at them because five people died on our streets.
Mm-hmm.
That was the anger that was in city council mm-hmm. when we had this shooting.
Mm-hmm.
What does that say? Mm-hmm. I mean, if you're under the gun and your citizens are yelling at you, and then your police department kills a teenager, what are you saying to us? We keep reaching out and they cut off our hands.
Mm-hmm.
So what does the mayor want from us? We can't trust him.
Mm-hmm.
He has to do something. You know what he has to do?
Talk to me.
He has to turn around and say, Mr. Marshman, you're no longer a police officer. Out of here. That lieutenant that covered for him, you're no longer a police officer. Out of here. The guy that did the shooting, you're out of here. I'll take my chances in arbitration, and they want to look at their lawyers because they got lousy lawyers
mm-hmm.
because they keep losing these cases,
mm-hmm.
which is amazing to me.
Mm-hmm.
I used to be a chief union steward on the other side, so it's amazing to me that they lose these cases. He has to do something drastic.
Mm-hmm.
You know what he could do? So easy. He could turn around tomorrow and say, I am asking the Federal Bureau of Investigation to come in and do an complete investigation, independent on this shooting.
Okay.
I am demanding it.
Mm-hmm.
I'll go to Washington if I have to. I want them in here. He could do that. And then we would look at him and say, okay, you did something. Let's applaud that.
Awesome.
And I would applaud him. I'd stand on City Hall steps and with my bullhorn and say, there's a good guy. He's doing something good. He's got to do stuff like that to get our trust back because he's lost it.
Mm-hmm.
It's only in office.
Mm-hmm.
2 months, 3 months, and he's lost it. He's worse than Trump.
Yeah, that's a tough one. Well, all due respect, I mean, there was a concern about the musical chairs because, you know, he started out as chair of the chair of the Multnomah County, did one term there, Then he basically went down to the treasurer, state treasurer, did one term there.
He chewed it for governor. We all know that.
In all due respect, you can't do that in Portland. Trust me. Things have changed here. Mm-hmm. Things have changed.
Well, we make demands. Important.
So, but like you said, I agree with you. We've invited him again. In all due respect, he's had the opportunity to look at the show. Hopefully, he'll look at this show. And hopefully, he'll respond to you guys. All due respect. Okay? Let's go, Mimi.
Bringing it back to what we're talking about.
Going on.
One of the things that he also needs to do that Hales didn't do is comply with the DOJ agreement. The cops have to have control. They have to, somebody's got to control the cops. And instead of thinking that we're the ones who need control by creating unconstitutional ordinances to keep us quiet, where the focus needs to go back to is that the cops need somebody to control them. And the DOJ came to the city to say, you guys are really screwed up, and your cops are killing mentally ill people. And now, that was years ago.
You make mention about the DOJ agreement. I mean, what's that all about? What is that about?
That's a whole other show.
But I'm just saying,
but
still,
in a nutshell, okay. The DOJ wants our cops, our mayor, who's in charge of the cops, to make the cops do the agreement that was set out a couple years ago to bring justice for all of us by controlling out of control cops. Mm-hmm. And the response has been no. Hales just said no. And now we have what we talked about earlier, which is this, that they're lying. They're not only not doing what the DOJ said, but they're lying to the people who are the overseers of making sure this process happens, lying about this employee information system, which is created to find cops who have a pattern of excessive use of force. So he has to get on board with the DOJ. He has to comply and do what the Department of Justice told him to do, whatever it was, 2 years ago. I can't remember when it was.
But don't the city, in all due respect, Doesn't the police organization, if you will, sign a contract with the city of Portland as far as the guidelines are concerned?
You're talking about a union contract.
Yeah, that's a whole different thing.
That's a whole different thing.
When the police act as egregiously and as murderously as our police as brutally as our police
do, that's the mayor's charge.
Then the feds come in and they say, this has to stop, and this is how we're going to make this stop.
Okay.
You're going to do this.
Okay.
And that's how bad our police force is, that the Department of Justice came here and said, we see you.
And I think that's still here.
It's still here.
Okay.
And it hasn't been done.
It's still in the federal court.
And Quantas Hayes died.
It's still in the federal court.
It's under Judge Michael Simon.
Well, that's this part. Right
that's
here.
This part.
Yeah.
And the original, what happened, this happens on a lot of cities, DOJ comes in, they do an investigation, it takes a long time, maybe a year or two, and then they come down and they say, yep, you guys are using excessive force. So we're going to take you into federal court, and the judge is going to decide, we're going to hold a trial. They turn around, they go into mediation, and then they make an agreement. So the city says, I will do boom, 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 this, and don't take it to trial. And the judge says, okay, are you happy with that, Department of Justice? Department of Justice says, yes, we're happy with that agreement. Okay, now, to get them to do the agreement, look what happened. They were supposed to create this organization called the co-op.
Okay.
Okay, it's disbanded. They don't have it anymore. They took it out.
The co-op, these made of citizens?
Because some of the citizens, including me, went to the co-op, and
the mayor was supposed to be part of it.
The mayor was supposed to be part of it.
Hales never went. Never once. Never went to a co-op meeting.
We went in and we said, we want the co-op to go into the community and find out what the community wants.
But wasn't
that's
there
their charge.
But wasn't there a black woman that was a chair that was Sadat?
Yes.
Wasn't it a black woman? What's her name? Sadat, right?
Sadat.
Sadat.
Yes.
Yeah, Sadat. She was a chair. Very strong woman.
I'm staying away from her.
Yeah, me too.
Yeah,
me
I'm staying
too.
Away from her.
But I think she quit. She quit. I think
she resigned.
That was a lot of conflict.
Jeez.
But she was making over $100,000 also.
How much?
Over $100,000.
She was making $100,000, over $100,000. Some say $140,000 with benefits. The people that were serving on the committees, nothing. They were volunteers. We couldn't even get them stipends. We spent We spent weeks at the, I mean, we yelled and screamed and begged to get them stipends.
Okay, well, go back to what they did, the co-op, and what they didn't do.
The co-op had 95 recommendations. They gave it to the, it's called the COCAL, which is the top committee from Chicago, consultants that came in, was supposed to work with the city to make sure the city complied with the orders of the Department of Justice. Okay, they had 95.
Okay, wait, let me stop you. Don't lose your thought, because that's who, this that Chicago team is who the Portland police lied to, what we've been talking about. They lied to who Joe's talking about right now. That's where the lie from the cops went to. So this is in response.
They were supposed to take what the community was, community would testify in front of the co-op. They would come and give testimony, and then the co-op would take that to the COCAL, and the COCAL would take it to the Department of Justice. Department of Justice would take it to the city, and then it would be done. 95 recommendations. You know how many they acted on in 2 years?
Mm.
One.
Which was?
I don't know, but I think it was something to do with transparency, but it was a minor one.
What were some of the other 95? Just anything that stands out that you might be able to just say, this was one of them?
They wanted the more independence for the co-op, which, it, you know, think about the two of them separate.
Mm-hmm.
The co-op wanted to separate.
Mm-hmm.
They wanted to do their own thing. And they wanted to do direct recommendations to the Department of Justice and skip past the COCAL.
Okay.
Well, the COCAL, you're talking about millions of dollars now in money that we're spending on this.
Wait a minute. Sadat was the only one that was getting paid.
No.
How you going to get $1 million?
You got the COCAL that we're getting $75,000 just for transportation to fly in from Chicago to here. 75 grand. They were spending money like crazy, but the volunteers, zero. We could not get them stipends. We couldn't get them reimbursement.
Well, look at it. Let's talk about it.
And it finally dissolved itself.
Let's talk a little bit about maybe a solution to it. Now, the mayor really should be on top of this whole thing.
Yes.
Should be actually communicating to the public.
He's the
about
one that
DOJ,
let it go.
The whole nine yards. Well, then now the second person, that, as far as I'm concerned, in my mindset, is the police department. And it just so happened, we happen to have, it's very rarity, to have the president of a police union to be black. His name is Daryl Turner. He's a neat guy. Neat guy. I've been knowing him. You know, he's an army guy, if you will. But the bottom line is that he's responsible. So let's say if he was, what if he came on the show and let's say gave us some definition of the guidelines for shooting.
You know who this guy is you're talking about? Let me tell you who this guy is that you're talking about.
Right.
Okay. This guy is a man who said, Daryl Turner. We're talking about. He said that he's shocked that Chief Marshman and his lieutenant, Michael Leisure, got put on administrative leave. Okay? He said he's shocked. Where has this guy been? I'm serious.
And when was this?
This just happened. This was a day
right
ago.
Now.
Like 2 days ago.
Administrative leave.
Not Daryl Turner, Chief Marshman.
Chief Marshman.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Just recently.
Yeah, like Thursday.
Dismissed.
Yeah, not signing in and...
Well, no, we don't know why yet.
Well, yeah, we're guessing.
I don't know why.
That's what's coming out, little by little.
It could be anything. I'm not even guessing that.
The leaks.
But what the point is that I'm making is that Daryl Turner, who runs the cops, who has seen the cops kill Quanis Hayes, the cops brutalize people in on two mass protests that just went down, use weapons and agree to have the cops use weapons that are illegal to be used, different forms of grenades and tear gas, different types that are illegal. We brought this to City Council last week. He knows all that, and yet the guy you're talking about said he's shocked. Why would he be shocked? He's either, and I don't believe this, not paying attention. He's guiding this. This man guides this brutality. If you run an organization, let's take, remember when Nike was using sweatshops in different countries?
Oh yeah, I remember.
Okay,
that. I remember that.
Well, who's responsible for that? The guy at the top of Nike is responsible for that, right? And if the shit hits the fan, and I did curse, the guy at the top or the woman at the top gets the charge, you know? And in this case, that's Daryl Turner. And for Daryl Turner, I'm appalled that he said he's shocked that this happened to Marshman. How can you be shocked? How can you be shocked that Andrew Hearst, who killed a mentally ill person and walked, killed Quanis Hayes? How can you be shocked? Oh, because you're not doing this? Because you're not looking into what cops on your force have their own mental issues, you know, who need to be looked at,
but
who lie to the DOJ?
But what if we were able to give him an
He's
opportunity
gonna sit here and
to
lie.
Share?
Okay. Go right ahead. We'll dispel all of his lies.
Understand, because I was a chief union steward, I have some understanding of what Turner goes through.
Okay.
Turner's job is only to protect his people that he represents. Mm-hmm. That's it.
Right, it's union. Right.
Ask him to go on a reasonable side to understand what's on the other side of his membership. He's not going to do that. That's not his job. He has no interest in doing it, and he doesn't have the time to do it. Mm-hmm. He represents his guys. That's it. And he will represent them the best he can, even if he disagrees with them. Mm-hmm. I had to handle cases that I disagreed with, but I went in there and fought like hell for them anyway, because they're entitled to that. Mm-hmm. And his people are entitled to his best representation. Right. That's not a defense on Turner. Turner has some problems. This is one of them. You cannot make statements like this and have credibility, even though under his responsibility, the chief of police does not fall. He's not responsible for the chief. He's responsible for the cops.
The line.
So, Turner is a really interesting guy because you're right. He's African American. He's not a bad guy. He kids around with me when he meets me. And at the same token, he makes statements that just makes you go back. The judge, Judge Michael Simon, lectured him for about 5 minutes because he made stupid statements to the judge. And the judge turned around and lectured him.
That was in regards to what?
To the settlement agreement.
The settlement agreement.
So he's got some problems.
I know that what you try, Bruce, I'm noticing, to find solutions to things, but you can't get solutions to things when this is another issue that, that is part of this whole, the Quanis Hayes, it's part of corrupt cops, it's a corrupt union, corrupt deals, corrupt contracts, corrupt incest with the city council and the cops, the mayor and the cops. You can't get a solution that's going to work for people when that corruption is allowed. And so the people who are corrupt are going to do everything that they can to protect their abilities to stay corrupt. And what they're doing now, right now, is this, and this came out from the Albina Ministerial Alliance in their statement yesterday. In a time when we are dealing with one of the most explosive issues in our city and nation, this city's legal team is appealing to the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals to remove federal judge Michael Simon from the settlement agreement brought by the Department of Justice and the AMA Coalition to reform the police bureau. What our city lawyers are doing.
One more time, do that one more time.
What our city lawyers are doing right now is appealing to the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals to remove Michael Simon because Michael Simon, as a judge, because Michael Simon, like we know from what Joe had just said a few minutes ago, is fair and he's real.
Now, well, that's under Charlie Hill, right?
This is now. Yeah.
Mayor Wheeler's making it basically.
It's coming from the city lawyers, the city legal team.
Wow.
Yep. They're appealing to remove Judge Simon because Judge Simon is really good at what he does because he won't accept the lies. He's not corrupt.
He wanted to, Judge Simon wanted to call him back into court to explain some stuff. So he has jurisdiction of this settlement case between the Department of Justice and the city. So he wanted to call them back in and say, I want to talk to you some more. I did some things that I don't remember. His authority is limited in this stuff. And he acknowledges that. But the city got really ticked that he wanted them to come into court and answer some questions. And they said, no, you're only allowed to do that once a year. And the judge said, no, I have jurisdiction of this case, and you're going to come into court. And they said, no, we're going to appeal it to the Ninth Circuit. So that's where they are. They're in the Ninth Circuit trying to get a really well-loved judge overturned. There is no way.
Well, make it clear now. Now, you got the mayor and you got four city council people. Have they all signed off on that statement?
This is being done by the city's legal team.
No, but I'm just saying. You know what I'm saying?
They don't have to sign
off. City signed off. I forget.
But who's responsible? My point is, who is responsible?
I think Novick might have voted against it. It might have went 4-1.
This statement here?
Yeah. In order to do an appeal to the Ninth Circuit, the city has to pass a resolution. It's not an ordinance. Okay. A resolution allowing the city attorney to go.
Okay.
So the city attorney comes before the council and says, I want to do
this. Well, that's what I'm saying. That's the point I'm making. Meaning that the mayor and the other four
they
all signed off on it.
Except, so, I think, Novick.
I'm talking about you, Daly, now. What about you, Daly?
She wasn't there when this went down.
That's a whole different situation.
But this is going down now.
That's going down now. So she knows about this particular piece. How is she? Any feedback from her?
She doesn't comment on this stuff.
I'll comment
get her on.
On
Gee,
that's another story. I'm have to do another show.
Daily.
We may have to do the next show again. What the heck? I mean, before we leave,
you Daly is brand new.
Okay, real quick.
We wanted to give her lots of time to get used to what she's doing, but she voted for the exclusion of activists confronting the council, which means 60 days you can't go into any of the buildings, any of the Portland buildings. All right, they can do that according to this new thing that they want to do.
That just happened,
and she voted for that.
This was all last week's show. Yeah,
there was another point about, so I think that's legal now, right?
No. It doesn't go into effect for 30 days. We're down to about 25
and
now.
And the confusion about
What about your case? What about his case?
That's part of that. But the confusion around what they did in that ordinance in agreeing, all five of them, to do that exclusion, is that it doesn't go into effect for 30 days. But at the same time, the mayor said, we will not be putting it into effect even after the 30 days if a judge doesn't sort of sign off on it. And it's really bizarre. It's like, so what are you doing, mayor, city, about having a judge sign off on it? Are you truly not going to exclude people for this ambiguous amount of time and random amount of time? Joe could get 60 days, I could get 2. You know, who knows? How do you decide?
Yeah, it's very subjective.
And also, if you are doing something about it, what was your move? How come we don't know what that was? Has a judge agreed to talk to you? What judge? Who? And probably Judge Simon. And
you're trying to get rid of John. Gee. Real quick, we got about another 8 minutes. What about the homeless issue? Where are we on that, real quick?
The homeless issue, and just before the shooting, was the uproar. That was the uproar that was going on in the council. Right. We were shutting down the council because people were dying on the streets. Mm-hmm. We got really upset over that. There were 5 people that died that we know of.
6.
Probably more. 6. And
so where are we now on that piece right now?
We're nowhere. R2-D2 is going to be shut out in April. They've been ordered to evacuate where they are. They're being evicted. So that whole great experiment that's been there for 5 years is going to be gone in April. And Ted Wheeler, even though the neighborhood said, leave them there, Ted Wheeler said, no, they got to go.
Oh, well, and there's more. So there's R2-D2, and then there's Hazelnut Grove.
Hazelnut Grove's in serious trouble with the neighborhoods, that they want them out of there. All right, so there's pressure. And Ted Wheeler went down, and Chloe and Ted Wheeler went down and checked it out and stuff and said really sugar words, okay? But they're going to be excluded. You watch, because Forgotten Realms, they've already taken out. Those were the 3 big ones.
Wow.
And we have Dignity Village, which is by the airport. It's out of everybody's sight, which is probably a good thing.
But then there's 5,000, 6,000, 7,000 other people who aren't part of any of this.
Well, now I guess you just recently heard that the county, by the way, an Asian representative on Multnomah County, she was on one of the programs, just the Sunday Monday program, and they're coming out with an experimental kind of a trial deal. They're going to build 5 houses. And they're going to
micro houses,
micro housing. They're going to pick 5 families, and put those houses in the back, each of those houses.
Yeah, in Kenton.
You're talking about
two different things.
Yeah,
there's two different things.
Yeah, this one, she just kind of, yeah. And then at the tune of about $75,000 a piece for these little houses.
Right. Well, those are attachments to houses, and it's for five people.
This is a different piece.
Oh, that's another one. The one you're talking about is the women's camp.
That's a different ballgame. Yeah.
This is a village.
They're going to pick it up. I guess when I first saw it, was that, well, hey, if you really want to really commit yourself to that piece, you got five people at Multnomah County. You got the chair and the four other folks. What if they put them in their backyard to start with, as an example?
Right.
I'll ask that question on Thursday. Just to show the enthusiasm. That's a great question. Okay, you see what I'm saying?
Well, one of the things that I just asked Mayor Wheeler is because he's doing his TED Talks.
We got about 2 minutes. Keep going.
Okay, because he's doing his TED Talks with different communities.
Okay.
Which I do think is a good idea as long as action occurs following the TED Talks. I asked him if he would be willing to go into areas where there are houseless people anywhere. I'm not talking about the villages. Just out into the fields,
right?
And talk to people and find out where, I know the answers to this, but find out where is the city letting these people down?
Okay.
And then go to the city facilities, these nonprofits that are made to help these same people and fix that.
Okay. Well, folks, look. You got to be back here again. I'm sorry about that. we'll talk about it, right? Well, but anyway, this has been just great. I think the viewing audience has really got quite a bit of information today, and that's what it's all about. We've got to communicate. And hey, Mr. Mayor, be my guest. Please, be my guest. We appreciate that, okay? And again, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Thanks again, folks.
We'll see you next week, okay? Have a good one. Look like I've got about another 30 seconds. Boy, that's even better. Hey, vets, get out there and get your card, you know? Get out there and register. Register to vote for yourself and get those services. It's very, very, very important. And again, in fact, I might be talking to maybe the president of the police union and see if I can get Daryl to come on and talk about the guidelines for shooting or something of that nature. But give him the opportunity to respond to some of the points that were made today, which is good because all due respect, the mayor should be doing that, but hey, we're going to do whatever we can to get the situation. Mm-hmm. That's what it's all about, okay? About the solution, folks. Communicate. Take care. Have a good evening. We'll see you next week. They may be back.